We're going to talk about Cambridge University Press real quick, because one of the arguments is that the people presenting the evidence are not scholars and that we don't have PhDs and all this other stuff that they think matters. Oh, excuse me, drop my water bottle. All this other stuff that they think matters. But the thing is, credentialed universities, reputable people have put out this information, and we're reading it to you. We're bringing it to light. We're showing it to you. Some of this has been around for a long time. Other people have brought it out. Some stuff is just now being brought out. But the fact is, this information exists, and reputable sources have put it out, and they have not debunked these sources. So we're going to read real quick about Cambridge University Press, just so you can see who they are for those of you who have never heard of Cambridge University Press. It says, Cambridge University Press is part of the University of Cambridge. Our mission is to unlock people's potential with the best learning and research solutions. Our vision is a world of learning and research inspired by Cambridge. Our peer-reviewed publishing list comprise over 53,000 titles covering academic research, professional development, over 350 journals, school-level education, English language teaching, and Bible publishing. This list is growing every year and spans subjects from aesthetics through to zoology, with authors ranging from Shakespeare to English language teaching author Ray Murphy. A pioneer in our field, we are committed to supporting innovation in learning and teaching. We publish without boundaries, ensuring our resources are accessible across the globe in print, online, and other digital formats. We take pride in supporting community programs across the globe. Staff are encouraged to offer practical help, advice, and funding to nurture vital, charitable, educational, and voluntary partnerships. Playing a lead role in today's global marketplace, we have over 50 offices around the globe and distribute our products to nearly every country in the world. We publish 50,000 authors based in over 100 different countries. So Cambridge University Press is huge. This is important. They are huge, and they have credentials, and they have peer-reviewed publishing list that comprises over 53,000 titles. So they are peer-reviewed multiple times. So let's talk about what we're going to talk about today. This author, Ulysses Santamaria, it's hard to find any information on Ulysses Santamaria. So I dug up what I could find, and here's an article from 1991, Talos Press Publishing. And I'm going to tie all this together in a second. The news of Ulysses Santamaria's death in Florence on February 25th, 1991, stunned his friends in Europe and the U.S. An attack of bronchitis had left him in a coma. Rushed to the hospital, he did not survive. Ulysses' death was difficult to believe because he was a survivor, but it seems we never knew who Ulysses really was, no matter how much we loved him. We knew him as a free-floating intellectual who had landed in Paris through a series of coincidences and mishaps. He managed to make do through scholarships and part-time jobs. Most of his intellectual work was concerned with problems of race, discrimination, and identity among Blacks in the U.S., Europe, Israel, and the Caribbean. One more time. Most of his intellectual work was concerned with the problems of race, discrimination, and identity among Blacks in the U.S., Europe, Israel, and the Caribbean. So anyway, this document that I'm about to read from Cambridge University Press, written by Ulysses Santamaria, and that was the reason I gave you guys all that background first, so you know it's a credentialed university with peer-reviewed papers. You know that this guy spent his life handling race and identity concerning Blacks in the U.S., Europe, Jamaica, the Caribbean, all that stuff. So here it is right here. Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, or Politics versus Religion. This was published by Cambridge University Press in 1987. This is 24 pages, right? So now, this is an interesting document. I'm on JSTOR. For those of you who have, those of you who have never heard of JSTOR, these are peer-reviewed documents. These are university documents. It is, I think, $19 a month, $19.95 a month or something like that, if you want to be a pro member. But right now, during the pandemic, they are offering free accounts with up to, I think, 100 articles per month that you can pull. And that way you can read a lot of this stuff for free. Now, I want you guys to pay close attention to this. So when people come and say there's no evidence, you can prove them wrong. You can present this. When people say that there are no credentialed sources that say we are the people, you can show this to them. There will be a link in the description once this is done. I will post the link in the description. All right. So amongst the many religions, let me start over. Amongst the many religious groups to be found in the United States, one is remarkable and very little known, the Black Hebrews. This group shares structural characteristics common to many minorities, but is also distinguished by a dual identity derived from the experience of slavery and the cultural mix specific to the New World. They are the product of two eventful histories. There is a history of their race, the main events of which are well known. As black people brought from Africa, they were reduced to slavery, then freed. Their destiny is linked to that of the United States, where they form a second racial community. The other history is cultural, that of the Jewish tradition brought by the immigrants from Europe. The spread of this tradition amongst the Black community is more difficult to grasp. We will attempt both to improve our understanding of the interaction of this dual identity with the nature of Black American Judaism, and to pay particular attention to the study of the cultural influences of Judaism of the Mediterranean basin on the people of Black Africa, like the Ashantis, who were historically in contact with the Jews trading in these areas. These areas of Africa supply vast numbers of Blacks forcibly deported as slaves to the American continent. Who then are these Black Hebrews whose existence was only brought to our attention between 1960 and 1965? They come from the Black American world and are mainly to be found in the ghettos, where they claim to be true believers of the law of Moses and the descendants of those who conclude the alliance with Yahweh, that is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Scattered throughout the big cities of the East and the center like New York and Chicago, there in the United States as a whole, several thousand Blacks who believe in Judaism. But the ideology and the beliefs of this apparently homogenous, community are very varied and range from Orthodox Judaism to forms of Christianity. So now, even back then in 1987, when this was published, they understood that there was a difference. They weren't trying to lump us all together like some people in the so-called Christian community do now, mostly the urban apologists. They weren't trying to lump us all in one group. Ulysses understood that there were Christian Israelites as well as those that are keeping the law. The Journal of Christianity Today has set out a brief typology that distinguishes three categories of members in the Black Jewish community. One, those who speak of returning to Israel. Two, those who believe that Blacks are the true Jews and who accept Jesus as a prophet. Three, those who call themselves Black Israelites or Black Hebrews and who consider themselves direct descendants from the patriarchs. Like all classifications, this proves to be a somewhat arbitrary as well as an incomplete expression of the disparities that exist in the Black congregations at both the level of religious practice and belief. These categories are not watertight, and one particular congregation may have features of the other categories. This is the case of the B'nai Sakin Sar Shalom congregation in Chicago, part of whose membership is settled in Israel. They are scarcely mentioned before 1967, when several of them returned to Israel, the land of their fathers. This raised problems of integration and an internal split within their movement, which attracted a certain amount of publicity. The paradoxical search for an original ancestral and mythical place is comparable with the other tendencies of the Black American activist movements that inspire to return to Africa, which is sentimentally considered as the motherland. This quest for an origin and for African links has been strikingly described in Alex Haley's novel Roots. The author, a contemporary Black American, was able to reconstitute the genealogy of his family over time since the day in 1767 when his ancestor landed on American soil to be sold into slavery. It can be argued that there is significant correlation between American Black consciousness of their American Blacks consciousness of their Blackness, of their lack of a historical past, and the appearance of the Black Hebrews and Black Muslims. The fact that these two phenomena occurred at the same historical moment is evidence of this connection, the religious phenomena stemming from the social and cultural needs for an existence that is recognized, affirmed, and vindicated. To understand this religious phenomena, we need both to explore the premises of the movement and resituate the American Black. It was during the 60s that the Black American movement was organized and its claims intensified. Everyone knows the slogans, Black is beautiful, Black power. No one can be unaware of their resonance, their message, the implications they have for millions of Americans, white or Black. This political ideology as a whole is supported by a whole set of arguments, by philosophy, by a kind of cult Blackness, the color of Black skin, of racial identity. Does this apply an apology for Blackness, for Black power? The latter is created and finds its justification and its roots in pseudo-biblical or religious explanation. It creates its own theology, the theology of Black power. Does this mean political power that needs to be supported by a religious justification? This appropriation of a religion, of a history, is intimately connected with the search for an identity, a legitimacy for their race, and it leads them to the conclusion that the Black Hebrews are descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It is they who are the holders of the true faith. It is they who are the authentic Jews. But because their own past escapes them, because slavery destroyed every trace of their individual and social existence on American soil till 1865, the day of the prohibition of slavery, they have had to rediscover their own racial, social, and political identity and the need and the desire to affirm their Blackness, even their absolute superiority in all areas over the white man. But despite all the arguments, the legitimation of their claims, the vindication of their racial anteriority, they cannot deny that they lost their motherland. America is the land of the white man, the oppressors, those who love the master that beats them, and the earth that he stagnates in is a human dog. And this is where the second claim made by Black power comes in. The Blacks need their own country, a country for the Blacks. But what land? African land? America, the mother of all descendants of the slaves torn from their native land? In the same way that Palestine was the land of the Hebrews, McGuire talks of Africa for Africans, for the American Blacks who are expatriate Africans. We know that Liberia became their country of refuge. Let me go down some. We know that Liberia became their country of refuge, their rediscovered land. And the parallel, the return to one's origins, is established with the people of Israel who finally found a land, their land, the land of their ancestors after having been deported, oppressed, persecuted people. But who is Israel? Who are the authentic descendants of the patriarchs? The reply of the Black Hebrews is simple. We are the authentic descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We are the descendants of the patriarchs. The land of Israel thus reverts to them as a right. The land of Israel is the land of their ancestors. Now, this is interesting because there are other documents that say Cambridge was in control of a lot of research concerning the identity of who we are. And this is important because right now he's establishing a part of his premise. And as we go, we're going to see that he slowly starts to bring out some information about who we are and where we came from. All right. So to justify this, to reinforce the arguments, a whole detailed genealogy is drawn up. This is derived from the Holy Scriptures, their only written archives. A selection of verses is selected, which are subject to detailed and pointed interpretation, which reveals the validity of their claims. Again, we have to note the interaction between the color of skin and religion, because the Black Muslims have the same racial and religious problem. In both cases, we have to ask whether the basic problem is not, in fact, the issue of being Black. if it is the fact of being black that is actually prior to the fact of being Jewish or Muslim. But before asking this question, we need to understand the historical, the socio-historical process that led to the creation of the black Jewish community in the U.S. and the sources for and the validity of the discourse of legitimation adopted by this community to raise the consciousness of its followers and enable them to recognize themselves as a unique group in relation to other black, white, and Israelite communities. All right, so blacks and Jews, the same claim, the premise of the movements. Now, listen to this part right here. In the first months of 1879, remember, some of these people say that the movement didn't start till the 1960s, 1960, 1965, and he went over this in the beginning. In the first months of 1879, there was a massive migration of some 5,000 blacks to the northern territories of the United States, mainly Kansas and Oklahoma. This exodus was of despairing blacks seeking refuge, a place where their political rights would mean something, where they would be free from economic exploitation and above all from the dangerous activities of the Ku Klux Klan. One of the members of this exodus was Benjamin Pap Singleton, an elderly and colorful man who led a group of 300 blacks to Cherokee County in Kansas. There they founded a colony, Singleton's colony, Singleton calling himself the Moses of the Exodus of colored people. From 1900 onwards, North and South Carolina were overrun by black preachers who were propagating a doctrine according to which the lost tribes of the House of Israel was none other than the Negroes. So from the 1900s onwards, so the 1879, you had that mass migration. So from the 1900s onwards, they start preaching this. Although this might at first sight seem an odd claim, it can be seen as reflecting the beliefs that some black slaves had held during their captivity when they were interrogated on their origins, their destiny. A historical example supports this hypothesis. A slave uprising took place in Richmond, Virginia, at the beginning of the 19th century. So understand, that's the 1800s. The beginning of the 19th century is the 1800s. The beginning of the 1800s. A slave uprising took place in Richmond, Virginia at the beginning of the 19th century, which was led by a slave called Gabriel Prosser, an outstanding personality who had acquired some knowledge of the Bible. He frequently referred to it in order to convince his brothers that they were the descendants of the Israelites and that God would free them from slavery as he had their ancestors. So now you have a slave at the beginning of the 1800s who uses the Bible to come to the conclusion that they are Israel. He also says that many slaves held the belief that they were Israelites when interrogated on their origins. And yet the people in the UA and some of these other people who claim to be Christians will tell you that we are making this stuff up. We have created this out of thin air. There's no evidence, no proof, none of that. He identified himself with Samson, his favorite biblical character. Like Samson, he wore his hair long as a sign given by God of the alliance made with his people. Gabriel Prosser was convinced that God had chosen him to free his people from the depths of slavery. Like a black Samson, he would break the chains of slavery and found a nation of free blacks in America. His fall was dramatic. During a night raid, a violent storm broke. His companions, petrified, fled. Convinced that they were the victims of divine wrath, they abandoned him. What should be emphasized here is the impact of the Old Testament, the sacred book of the Jews, on Negro mentality. As evidence of its importance, one has only to look at black popular culture, which has become an expression of this. Remember, this is written in this is published in 1987. In the history of the Jews, the history of Israel written down in what the Christians call the Old Testament, the divine being is accessible. God is revealed to man. This contact, this type of relationship with the divine being inevitably attracted the black spirit. What's more secure than a God who is responsive to his people's suffering, aware of their poverty, helping them in exile, leading them from slavery? The history of the Jewish people, persecuted, dispersed, exiled, reduced to slavery, must have seemed close to that of the blacks who themselves were reduced to slavery. The ancient Hebrews were saved from slavery, and the blacks would be too. The social context of America at the beginning of the century explains the basis of the doctrine taught by the black preachers who journeyed across Carolina. At this period, popular white racism was undergoing a revival, which was seen in all kinds of reviews, tracts, plays, and public speeches. Between 1900 and 1910, books such as The Negro, a Beast in the Image of God, or even The Negro, a Menace to Civilization, were extremely successful. Between 1901 and 1909, Ben Tillman argued at public meetings that the Negroes were the same family as monkeys. Their race was debauched and ignorant. This increase of white racism was not the sole prerogative of the Southern states, but was found throughout America. The Negroes were not slow to react to this racist movement. As a response to the virulent attacks of their racist adversaries, they developed the idea of the black people as a chosen nation, the chosen nation. Or so black people as a chosen nation, the chosen nation. However, in the history of mankind, the chosen people are the Jews. In addition to this social context, a second factor was important in this attraction felt by the blacks for the Jews in Judaism. The writer Booker T. Washington had after 1884 found a model for emancipated Negroes. For him, it was essential to preserve human dignity, and what people knew better how to do this than the Jews through their centuries of persecution. He wrote, "We have a brilliant and striking example in the history of the Jews in various countries. Nor the race has suffered as much in America and in other parts of the world, but they remained united. They kept their unity, their pride, their love for their race, and their importance grew through the centuries, even those countries where they were despised. And it is above all because they maintain their faith and their destiny. If the Negro does not learn to imitate the Jews in these areas, then he cannot hope to succeed." Other writers such as Benjamin Tucker Tanner took up his theme of the need for Negroes to imitate Jewish behavior. First of all, they could help the black population overcome their own social, political, and economic disorganizations. Black society had to be structured and given coherence in order to become stronger and more able to exist in a world of whites. Other writers such as, in the early years of the century, a third influential factor in terms of the religious behavior of some black groups. Before the First World War, the immigration of white Jews reached its peak. Then during the 4 years of the First World War, this movement stopped. During the post-war years, they poured in. These immigrants from Central Europe settled in the ghettos in large cities. And they were, they were artisans, traders, and workers. The same religious fervor that characterized their lives in Central Europe was found on American soil. Through their morals, customs, through their way of dressing, the Central European Jews displayed a way of living that is extraordinary in the world of the ghettos. Shout out to Larry Bryce in the super chat. Says their persistence in trying to escape from the sub-proletariat led to significant changes in their group, and between the 1920s and 40s, important social change began. Having profited from the prosperity produced by the First World War and enabled their children to acquire a better education, those Jews who had been workers or small tradespeople began to leave the ghettos to move to new areas of the big cities. And thus, in New York, there were 33,000 Jews living in the Lower East Side in 1916, but only 12,100 by 1930. From 1914 to 1920, the old Chicago ghetto lost half of its Jewish population. The same thing happened in Boston, Philadelphia, Baltimore, and other large centers of Jewish population. Now, if one looks at the religious position of American cities, the center of Jewish orthodoxy would be seen to reside in the ghettos of the large cities. The assumption that their everyday life was subject to intense interest was the subject of intense interest to their equally disinherited neighbors is not unlikely. The material conditions of the Jews in the ghettos are no different than that of the blacks. The latter inevitably saw the two societies lived in identical economic conditions. The religious fervor of the Central European Jews must have found an echo in the black soul. Some blacks did occasionally work as shabbos goyim, in other words, as non-Jews employed by Jews to carry out certain tasks in the synagogues, such as turning on the lights on the Sabbath. So basically, they used black people like labor, European Jews used black people like labor on the Sabbath. Shout out to War Raw in the chat and Marrero Morgan. I appreciate that. So they used black Jews like labor on the Sabbath. After the War of Secession, there was a mushrooming of black churches, and the influence of black preachers and prophets was in proportion to their knowledge of the Old Testament. On all evidence, the most favorite texts were those which traced the history of Israel rather than the New Testament, the Christian text. Christianity had been compromised by slavery since it was the religion of their old master, and as a result was unacceptable. The blacks were more familiar with the Old Testament, the Bible of the Jews. They took it as transcribed from the actual words spoken by God himself and had great admiration for the patriarchs and their history. This admiration, which was not untinged by jealousy, the blacks wanted both to identify with and imitate the modern Jew. This was not a sudden occurrence, since this crisis of identity had occurred sometime before this. So he's telling you this existed before, and he's already said the slaves that were interviewed already told them that they were Israelites. But through perceiving themselves as Jews, they took on a known identity, one accepted by all civilized people. Furthermore, the blacks had seen the Jews who lived beside them and had watched and understood their social ascent, their financial success, their progressive integrations into the richer classes. The proximity of the white Jews had considerable effect on the black population of the ghettos. Through watching them live, they had recognized the validity of Washington's statements on the need for the blacks to model themselves on the Jews. Now, the establishment of communities of black Jews. Around 1915, the first communities of black Jews were organized, which called their members black Jews. Now, hold on real quick. Let me finish this real quick and then I'll throw in my thought. They started out in the Washington, Philadelphia, New York, and in other less important towns of the East. Now, this is leading somewhere. And the reason this is important is because he's giving the background of what's going on and what people believed. The entire feel of this is going to change soon. So I also want to point out that a lot of the stuff that he is pointing out, he understands there's a difference. I want to point that out one more time. While the urban apologists and other Christian groups fail to separate us and they pretend like we are all, you know, one big group and we're all associated with the camps in one West and we're all lumped together, here in 1987, when this was published, they understood that there was differences. They were not, everybody wasn't all the same. It says around 1915, the first communities of black Jews were organized, which called them their members black Jews. They started out in Washington, Philadelphia, New York, and the other less important towns of the East. Their most significant characteristics lay in their personal interpretation and rudimentary knowledge of the law and customs of the Orthodox Jews. Some allowed the eating of pork, while others turned this prohibition into the central tenet of their belief system. Some even saw Jesus as a black Jew who had been persecuted by the Gentiles. In Philadelphia, under the leadership of the prophet Cherry, the Church of God group stated that the label Negroes was erroneous since the real Jews were black. They saw the church as a synagogue. Their ritual and religious practices consisted of ceremonies prescribed by Cherry himself, who referred to them as the Holy Writings. He made a clergy and religious services started with the beating of a drum. The faithful studied Hebrew, and Cherry had a Bible in Yiddish and in Hebrew, although services were not celebrated in the latter languages or the latter language. In New York, the community of black Jews attempted to establish contacts with Orthodox Jews whose religion was not only centered on the Bible, but also on the tradition of the Talmud. Between 1919 and 1931, there were nearly 8 black Jewish synagogues in Harlem. Several black rabbis took Jewish names: Mordecai Herman, Ishi Kaufman, Israel Ben Yoman, Israel Ben Human, and Simon Schutz. The leaders of such groups were often charismatic men. Thus, at the head of the Beth B'nai Abraham congregation was an extraordinary man named Arnold Ford. His origins and his death remain a mystery, as those of a prophet, and still give rise to speculation. He studied Hebrew with the Jewish immigrant, and his knowledge of the Talmud enabled him to include some of its rules into his group. Like many black Jews in the 20s, he was attracted by Marcus Garvey's movement, and in the capacity he became the musical director of Liberty Hall, the headquarters of Garveyism in New York. His congregation was dissolved in 1930, unable to keep going after his disappearance. All right, let me see here. After this, another significant figure in Black Judaism arrived on the scene, Wentworth A. Matthew. It is he who incontestably was the most influential and most renowned of all the spiritual leaders of the Black Jewish communities. His congregation was undoubtedly the most important in Harlem, not solely because of its size, but through its reputation. The Commandment Keepers, Congregation of the Living God, or even the Royal Order of the Ethiopian Hebrews, or the son and daughters of culture, have existed legally since 1930. The New York court, in one of its judgments, recognized its right to call itself Jewish. Through highly controversial means, Rabbi A. Matthew attempted to claim connections with Ethiopian Judaism, that of the Falashas. His movement was certainly closest to Jewish orthodoxy, and his position in respect to those of his color was frequently ambiguous. The oldest members of his group were from the British Caribbean. One of the most dominant figures of this group, Marcus Garvey, interestingly called himself the Black Moses. But the members of the group were, in general, socioeconomic terms identical to other Harlem groups. They were workers. The oldest were day laborers. The youngest had jobs which required some manual skills in light industry or in commerce in New York. As a general rule, they tried to maintain steady and regular employment. Women formed a majority of the group as a whole. It was a tightly knit community under the absolute direction of Matthew, to whom the members had to vow great respect. The core of their lives was their religious existence. It could indeed be said that the religious life determined their existence. They went after all three or four times a week to service at the congregation. The program of social assistance was primarily aimed at combating juvenile delinquency widespread in Harlem within the group. The assertion of paternal authority and the strict obedience of the children was considered as one of the means to achieve this. The education and instruction of the members was undertaken at both the individual and the group level. So financial support was assured for any member of the group who proved his or her need for reasons of health or unemployment. Matthew aimed to give his flock a moral and religious education. Both physical and moral backsliding was prohibited. Traditional morals values dominated. The family, justice, work, probity. By creating an ethic for Black men, he was in a better position to combat the pernicious influence of white domination. Seeing himself as the leader of the Black Jews in Harlem, Matthew, despite the relatively limited importance of his group, was a popular figure, regularly featured in the press. Branches of the group existed in Philadelphia, Media, Pittsburgh, Sharon, Virginia, as well as Youngstown, Antrim, Ohio, Chicago, Cullen, St. Chicago was the second town in the U.S. in terms of importance of its Black Jewish community. There were five large congregations there, and around them some half dozen less important ones. The different groups maintained a certain unity, and at the beginning of November 1967, they formed the United Leadership Council of Hebrew Israelites, which represented the fusion of four groups from the Black Jews under the direction of Rabbis Robert Devine, James Hodge, Wafrali Ben Israel, and Richard Nolan. These men, helped by some white rabbis, founded the association named the Chicago Fellowship of Racial Jews, which was designed to organize special teaching courses for Black Jewish communities. In the same way, a group of Black and white Jews formed in 1965 called the Hadzah Harishon, which tried to make education available to a large number of Blacks. The New York Times, in an article in October 1968, quoted the intervention of the president, Hadzah Harishon, Miss Esther Bibbins, "We are proud to be both Black and Jewish." One congregation of Black Jews was, however, excluded from the work of the ULCHI, the congregation of B'nai Zaki and Shar Shalom. Their resentment at having to conform undoubtedly reflected the ambiguous personality of their leader, Ben Ami Carter. He had discovered Judaism in 1960 with the so-called Rabbi Fred Lang. After a year, he left him and studied with Rabbi Abihu Rubin of the Congregation of Ethiopian Jews. one of the offshoots of A. Matthews Group. In 1961, he had the name Ben-Ami, which means son of my people, to that of Carter. And in 1963, became the head of the congregation, Ben Zakin Shar Shalom, descendants of the elders, Prince of Peace. So as we keep going, now I'm going to skip forward to some of this. Let me see here. Here we go. We're going to, let's see. Yeah, we're going to skip forward to here. Now, this is where it starts to take a turn as we get into page, and we're going to get to page 31. All right. In terms of religious practice, the syncretism in such that both Orthodox and Christian rules are combined. In fact, two phases can be identified in the propagation of the Jewish religion within Black American society: the period which followed the First World War and the 1960s. Undoubtedly, the majority of Black Jews were converted to Judaism after the First World War. The Black Jewish communities were most highly structured in terms of their religious ideology. Let me see. Oh, there we go. This is starting to, like, all the words starting to run together. Appeared in this period. Also, in the same period, an important part of the white Jewish community left the ghettos. The areas of first settlement to live in the areas of second settlement. Nevertheless, during the 20s, millions of Jews still lived in the New York ghettos. Through the process of culture and economic selection, those who remained were not only the poorest, but the most religious. The Black population can be seen to have undergone and a posteriori conversion. The term convert should, however, be qualified and juxtaposed with a term mimetic. Thus, a mimetic conversion can explain the appropriation of the Jewish religion by some Blacks from the ghettos, an appropriation which went from a pure and simple annexation to a search for assimilation and recognition from white Jewish communities. Again, this period saw among the Blacks in the United States the beginnings of a profoundly important movement, the search for an identity, their identity. Through Marcus Garvey, Blacks rediscovered their pride of being Black, but he encouraged them to rediscover their roots to justify and legitimate their existence. The identification of their conditions of life with those of the Hebrew people was only one stage in their line of argument. The same found among Black Protestants who claimed that the patriarchs are Black. There were far fewer conversions after the Second World War. During the 60s, a totally new current developed. Black Jewish communities were created that were ideologically distinct from the older ones. The primary search for communal religious life gave way to a search for a glorious identity, or at least a historical one. Although this rewriting of the history of the Jewish people is common to all Black groups, the variations correspond to the social and political structure of each group. But for all Black Jews, it is religion that guarantees their origins and their identity. They define themselves in terms of a religion and in the context of a religion. They are Black. Their religion is the original religion of the Black men. They rediscover not only their identity, but also their pride in existence and the religion of their race. Black Jews, or more accurately, Black Hebrews, as they want to call themselves, claim a racial religion, race and religion being tightly connected and intertwined with race determining religion, and religion become one of the criteria for race. After all, isn't religion at the beginnings of the history of the race? Yeah, there we go. After all, isn't religion at the beginnings of the history of the race? This principle unites all communities of Black Jews, whatever their political differences. They preach the priority of the Black race, and a dialectic is developed which draws on arguments which support these assertions. It is appropriate to note at this point that the Black Jewish community's endlessly privileged teaching, the education of their members, and the access to a Judaic culture, the study of the Holy Book, and the teaching of Hebrew. This was undertaken through associations such as Hadzah Harishon, as an example, the new climate born in the 60s. This advance, which can be called intellectual, as a whole educated Black class, we can cite an example of Rudolph W. Windsor. I'm sure most of you are familiar with that name. He was born at an unknown date at Long Branch, New Jersey, where his family had lived for several years and belonged to various Jewish congregations. In Philadelphia, Rudolph Windsor began his studies in psychology and political science at the community college, and then studied at the Gratz College, which he left in 1967 with a diploma in Hebrew sciences. For those that say Rudolph Windsor cannot be trusted or his work has been debunked, he had a diploma in Hebrew sciences. He stayed in Philadelphia as a member of the Hebrew congregation at Adath Emeth Israel. In his book, From Babylon to Timbuktu, he wrote, "I want to write because in America, scholarly works, the history of the black man has been hidden. Moreover, books written on blacks have been appallingly distorted, badly analyzed, and reflect racial prejudice. I am convinced for myself that the only black men, I'm convinced for myself that only black men can write their history and that only then will the truth be told." Shout out to Melinda in the super chat. It is appreciated. So he believes that history can only be truthfully told through a black man. Where is it? "The basic objective of the book is to retrace the history of the Jewish people after their exile, the diaspora, which was connected to the Negro African bloc. The title of the book indicates the geographical and intellectual itinerary of the author. What is particularly interesting about the book is that it is a synthesis of a whole system of explanation. A whole theory which is constructed and structured by Black Jewish groups. The synchronic study of their existence acquires the charm of a myth, the mythology of Black Judaism." Now, in a society with non-existent collective memories, this is called the founding myth, for which the past only exists in fragments and cannot be discovered through tangible facts, events, written, or archaeological documents, there's a vital need to create an artificial mythical past. If this historical past does not exist, the society must in effect elaborate myths in order to explain its origins, its connections, its values as an element of continuity. Thus, the original myth formulates what a society claims as its origins at the beginning of time. It locates its structures, the religious and social basis of the group. The study of the myth reveals the ambitions of the human group that elaborated, adopted, and propagated it. For human groups or societies could have a few human groups or societies could have a greater need to attach themselves to a past or to create one than the Black American community. As Black men who were torn from the African continent, their homeland is Africa. America was originally peopled by Red Indians who were colonized by the white man. Black men were imported forcibly onto this continent. Their presence in America and why they were forced, why and the wherefore, hold on. The presence in America and why and the wherefore of their installation on American soil are known. The American plantations' increasing need for a servile labor force, for a slave labor force, which was collected by slave ships from the African coast and transported to the American continent. This traffic in black slaves was called the triangular traffic, since the stopping points of Europe, Africa, and America made a triangle. The deportation. The slave trade, now this is where we're coming into page 31, what I was telling you about. The slave trade began in the 15th century. So it's going to be in the 1400s with the discovery of the black continent and reached its apogee in the first half of the 19th century. So by the 1850s, this trade was essentially organized through stations, ports, and warehouses, which encircled the black African coastline like an iron belt. Places such as Argan Quarry. Oh, goodness, a lot of names. The islands of Lo, Elmina, Fernando, Posao, Tome, Luanda, etc., on the map of M. de Anville, 1729, the African coast is divided into seven sectors. Now, notice he's mentioned the African coast of 1720, or the map de Anville, 1729. Look that up if you haven't seen the map. The African coast is divided into seven sectors: Senegal, Sierra Leone, the countries of Gollum and Manuget or Guinea, the Ivory Coast, and the Kwawa, the Gold Coast, the Kingdom of Andres of Judah, and of Benin, the coast of Layango and Angola. Each sector was renowned for its provision of very specific human material. The KR blacks led revolts The Bambara were stupid, gentle, and tough. The blacks of the Gold Coast and the Ouida or Judah were good farmers but had suicidal tendencies, and the Congola were gay and good workers. Gay meaning happy, not gay meaning homosexual. The Negro was common money, a promissory note which could be counted on, a bill of exchange for a bill of exchange which discharged a debt of nature. Human flesh was the standard merchant values. The standard of negotiation was the Peace of India, which meant a Negro who conformed to calibrated physical criteria. How many Negroes were sold in this way? Quintanilla, I believe that's how you pronounce that, in his thesis on the black slave trade, estimates a total of some 80 million. 80 million people were traded as currency into slavery. But it could be argued that some 100 million men and women were torn from Africa from the 15th century onwards. In North America, only the southern states had a climate that the blacks could survive, and the southern planters employed them in such massive numbers that at the time of the War of Independence, the populations of the most prosperous regions of the United States were half black. This is how bad the slave trade was. When he arrived, the Negro was firstly deprived of his name. This is where we're talking about the stripping of identity. We get into the Psalms 83 conspiracy as part of that. When he arrived, the Negro was firstly deprived of his name, separated from his family and the others of his tribe. Why? So you can erase history. If people have their history together, they can talk and they can share stories and they can continue to pass it down. But once you start splitting everybody up, the history starts to get muddled and confused. That's why you have so many people believing that they're Israelite, but they don't really have the history. So When he arrived, the Negro was firstly deprived of his name, separated from his family and others of his tribe. The anonymity of servitude, the dispersion and rapid rotation of workers atomized them so much an extent that they became absolutely alienated objects. No social reference existed among these herds of slaves. They became social aliens, tallyable and workable at pleasure. In the 18th century, some Europeans began to talk of genocide. In England, it was the warnings of the religious groups such as the Quakers and the Methodists which produced the anti-slave movement. In 1834, all the slaves of the British Empire were freed. It was not until 1865 that the law for abolition of slavery in the USA was voted in. So England started to free the slaves. The abolition of slavery was giving of freedom returned. The abolition and the giving of freedom to, let me start over. The abolition of slavery and the giving of freedom returned some human dignity. They became men, members of society in which they had acquired potential rights. But what had to be resolved was the painful question of their origins and their identity. Who were they? They had indeed come from Africa, but from what part of Africa? Who were their ancestors? What were their tribes, their ethnic groups? An oral tradition which partially existed allowed some of them to remember their land, coming from the country where the river runs, originally from the banks of the great river. The memories of the motherland were there in their culture, and this Negro identification was expressed and conserved in their music. How many people have heard Kumbaya? I'm going to talk about that later, but if you go on to blackhistoryofthebible.com, you've seen the breakdown of Kumbaya, how it was a cry for help. It was preserved in their songs. But there was a need. It was a vital necessity to recreate a genealogical and historical past to fill in the great emptiness of slavery. So then there was the development, the elaboration of a whole mythic history, a mythology. Black American folklore reveals through its dominant theme the everyday myths of the American blacks alongside what we've called historical origin. Since it's substantiable by verifiable evidence, a whole mythic origin of the movement of black Jewishness was created. The hypothesis of the existence of African Jewish communities. Now, for those of you who have seen the evidence, you know that the evidence is all over for Jewishness in Africa. Let's see. We know that the Jewish religion is one which is passed from parents to children, and that it is the fundamental ingredient in the cohesion of the group. When one studies the Jewish religion, it is clear how much it serves as the nature of the context for society. In the case of Black Judaism, the study of the significance of religious life and social life can help to rediscover traces of a more ancient Judaism that some African groups could have adopted and that could have been conserved by their slave descendants on American soil. Let me read that again. We know that Jewish religion is one which is passed from parents to children and that it is fundamental ingredient in the cohesion of the group. When one studies the Jewish religion, it is clear how much it preserves as the armature, the context for society. In the case of Black Judaism, the study of the significance of religious life and social life can help to rediscover traces of a more ancient Judaism that some African groups could have adopted and that could have been conserved by their slave descendants in America. Were there Black slaves who were Jewish through religion who maintained the faith of their ancestors after they had been forcibly transported to America? Only through an analysis of the mythology of the Jewish African origins of the Black Hebrews will this become clear. The following are major sources that need to be considered in such an analysis. Now, this is important. The following are major sources that need to be considered. A, witnesses, tales of the explorers who mention the existence of communities of Black Jews on the African continent, in particular in areas where the slave ships picked up the Black slaves. B, rites and customs, which have more or less explicit analogies with those of Judaism. C, the semantics of the dialectology of some African societies reveal some features comparable with those of Judaism. D, the deduction, conclusion, anthropological work done in Africa. All right, cool. The ones are up. I'm putting the screen share back up so you guys can see where I'm at right here. And the link will be in the description so you guys can go back and read this whole thing for yourself. All right, cool. I'm going to keep going. It is well known that 1,500 years before Islam, Judaism was present in Africa. Travelers' tales and the stories of journeys across North America and the Sahara and the Sudan provide considerable evidence of the existence of Jewish communities. Perfect. All right, existence of Jewish communities on the African continent. We know that from the time of St. Jerome, 340 to 420, a chain of Jewish commercial towns stretched almost interrupted from Mauritania to India. We talked about the Black Jews of Cochin, India, and one of the Goaster pastors. St. Augustine learned Hebrew in Tanzim, where there was a Judeo-Syrian colony, which came from Cyrenaica. These groups went as far as Akkar in the southern Sahara, and according to the Chronicles of Sudan, the dynasty of the kings of Ghana originated in this group. Jewish contacts and influences with the Black Africa in this group. Jewish contacts and influences with Black Africa were also noted by the Arab geographers Ibn Bin Kordeb and El Bekri, who stated that the roots of the Trans-Saharan trade in which Jewish caravans and interpreters were involved culminated in Ghana and in the lower valley of the Senegal River in the 12th century. El Idrisi, which I touched on when I showed the map. Okay, so the screen's back up. Perfect. El Idrisi, the Andalusian geographer, also cited that the Hebrew colony of Lamlam, located 200 miles from Timbuktu, and the existence of two Jewish towns on the Niger River. Then one century later, Haji and Agwadi added this. There is a race of people in Togert called Majaharia who are converted Jews. Their women speak Hebrew in order to not be understood. From this period onwards, there was a very significant Jewish influence throughout North Africa to such an extent the Dominican missionaries had to learn Hebrew and Arabic. All right. So now he's going to get into some very interesting history right here, and he's going to tie all this Black Jew stuff to the Spain and Portugal and the Inquisition and all this other stuff we've talked about that they said that there's no proof for. But what about the south of this margin of Saharan contacts? In the reign of John II of Portugal, nearly 700 Jews were taken from their kin and deported to the island of São Tomé on the west coast of Africa. This island is close to Nigeria, Cameroon, and Gabon. Escaping from São Tomé, the Jews immigrated to the coast of Angola between 1484 and 1499. They must have settled in several Portuguese colonies and over the centuries mixed with the indigenous Black populations near the Congo and Gabon. In 1776, Black Jews called Mavumba or even Mavambo, Mayambo, May or Mavumba lived on the coast of Lango by the river named Rio Muni. It would seem that they adopted Christianity at the same time as Mennonism. Shout out to Diane Bryce, the super chat. Now, what's in here is that we know that they were forced to convert to Christianity, be deported or killed. And so they are practicing Christianity, but maintaining their Judaism. By 1847, David Livingstone discovered a group of educated Blacks living in the interior, some 200 miles from the coast of Luanda. These Blacks were called the Jews of Angola. They were good merchants, learned easily, and had the knowledge of Portuguese law and history. Why would Black Jews, the Jews of Angola, need to know Portuguese law if they had never been deported from Portugal? Just ask yourself that. It doesn't make sense what they're trying to teach. So we know that these people were deported, were Black, and we see this in other books. It says they were good merchants, learned easily, and had a knowledge of Portuguese law and history. They were often employed as clerks and writers. For Livingstone, there was no doubt but that these people were the descendants of those who had been deported from Portugal in the 15th century. We have right here published in a book by a university. It says there was no doubt but that these people were the descendants of those who had been deported from Portugal in the 15th century. Other evidence supports his intuition. In Savage Africa, a book or an article, Winwood Reed's writes of having met in Guinea Blacks claiming to be Portuguese around 1864. So now we have Blacks that claim to be Portuguese, which once again destroys her claim that these were white Jews being deported into the west coast of Africa from Portugal. Closer to our time, Dr. J. Kreppel noted sometime after the First World War that a large community of Black Jews existed in the interior of Dahomey. It says, one more time, closer to our time, Dr. J. Kreppel noted that sometime after the First World War that a large community of Black Jews existed in the interior of Dahomey. These Jews had the five books of Moses written on old parchment in Hebrew. This is in a Cambridge University book. All these disparate elements are evidence of the permanent presence of a Jewish tradition within African ethnic groups, which had at one time been in contact with the Jews who came from the Mediterranean, were converted, and had kept their faith and their way of life. Now, it's interesting that he still thinks that they adopted it, even though he's giving all this evidence saying, hey, this is what's here, this is what existed. He still believes that they are converts, even though they're not. But we know from the other documents that if they are the Portuguese Jews that were deported, they were not the converts. They were the original people, because I showed you the evidence before. I'll go back and pull up some of that stuff and tie all this together. I'm going to do addressing the evidence part seven when I tie all of this evidence together. With the contemporary period, it says history rescues myth. This is important. History rescues myth. With the contemporary period, a totally different attitude is evident among explorers, sociologists, and anthropologists. They do not merely state the existence of Black Jewish communities, but they attempt to analyze the customs, morals, rights, and languages of African societies to draw conclusions and advance hypotheses. J. Lighton Wilson was a missionary for 18 years in Africa. In his work, Western Africa, Its Histories, Condition and Prospects, London, 1856. So now this book is referencing a book from 1856. He states that in Senegambia, religion was a mixture of paganism, Judaism, and Islam, and that it is difficult to define the areas of influence of each of these religions. In Northern Guinea, paganism and Judaism were closely intertwined. In the South, and in the South, there were more traces of Christianity. He based his conclusions on the existence of some customs which seemed to him to be remnants of Judaism. Circumcision, the divisions of the tribes into 12 large families, the strict prohibition on marriage between families that were too closely linked, sacrifices which involved smearing blood on the altars and the lintels of the doorways, periods of mourning which involved shaving the head and wearing dirty clothes, possessions by demons, and purification. He was unable to get any references or precise explanations from the natives as to the origin of these traditional practices, and it is thus possible to see here Jewish influences. It is also possible that in West Africa, the Ashanti of the Gold Coast have been influenced by Judaism. There are traces of this in some of their beliefs and customs. The patrilineal system is common to the two societies, Jewish and Ashanti. Among the Ashanti, the marriage of girls is subject to the same rules as those of the girls of the Safavid who married the son of their father's uncle or their cousin. The Ashanti marriage ceremony was identical to that of the ancient Hebrews. And it's simple. The price of the marriage, including the offering of wine, presentation, and acceptance of presents, were all required as formalities. Among the Ashanti, the period of the mother's impurity lasted for a week after the birth was terminated. After the birth and was terminated by the Natia ritual, when the young Ashanti recites his own name, and on the 14th day, there's another ceremony of purification. Leviticus 12, 1 through 8, the purification of a mother. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, if a woman have conceived seed and born a man child, then she shall be unclean 7 days. According to the days of separation for her infirmity, shall she be unclean. And in the 8th day, the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised, and she shall then continue in the bold of her purifying 33 days. The sexual prohibitions on women during their periods are identical among the Ashanti and the Hebrews. Leviticus 15:19. And if a woman have an issue and her issue in her flesh be blood, she shall be put apart 7 days, and whoever touches her shall be unclean. Leviticus 18:19. Also, thou shalt not approach unto a woman to uncover her nakedness as long as she has put apart for uncleanness. Let me see here. In moving on to consider the semantic and dialectic domain among the Ashanti, we discover that there are clear similarities between some words used by them and other terms used in Hebrew. The Hebrew word tahara means purification and refers to the rite of expiation, which washes all dirt away. Leviticus 3:18-20. Homophonetically, the word is close to the Ashanti word Odwira, which means purification, and refers to the ritual ceremony, the smearing of ram's blood on the sword, which is the symbol of the clan. The Hebrew rite of the Feast of the Tabernacle is close to the Ashanti ritual of the presentation of the stool. These stools can be compared to the thrones, which they were sculpted seats of the chief. Since they are sculpted seats of the chiefs, and each is thought to be the home of the ancestral spirits, above all, that of the chief who had used it. Festivities last for 7 days, and the blood of the sacrificed rams is smeared over the stools. Leviticus 23:33-36. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the 7th month shall be for the Feast of Tabernacles, for the 7 days unto the Lord. On the first day shall be a holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein. 7 days ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It is a solemn assembly, and ye shall do no servile work therein. So what of the Ashanti concept of God and divinity? They believe in a supreme being, a God, a creator, Onayame, but their concept of the divine is not theorized. There are only indications in some proverbs. Captain R. Sutherland Rattray, who lived for 20 years in West Africa, collected some of these proverbs which contain the Ashanti image of God, and these appear in his book, Ashanti Proverbs, Oxford, 1916. Oxford is another university. Of all the land, Onayame is the first. In other words, God is prior to everything. Genesis 1, in the beginning was God. All men are the children of Onayame. No one is a child of the earth. God created man, Genesis 1:27. So God created man in his image, in his own image, in the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. These two Ashanti proverbs seem to us more expression of popular wisdom than of religious belief. Though they do transmit the perception, the ideas of the Ashanti have of the supreme being, their confidence in the order, which is a naturally good order, but what seems to be lacking is a sacred dimension through which they can be seen as more than the maxims dictated by everyday experience. If we now turn to the domain of the semantic, in the word Onayame, the supreme being of the Ashanti, the O is often omitted, and the word Inyame is used to designate God. For the Hebrews, Yahweh is the revealed God, and his word has an extraordinary vocal similarity with Inyame. which is also Nyankopon, the one and only, the Almighty. Saturday is their sacred day, so they keep the Sabbath. What is said for the Lord of the Sabbath? One of the attributes of Enyame is Bor Bor, which signifies the creator. The Hebrew verb bara, which means to create, is similar not so much for its consonants as for its meaning. Among West African tribes, the terminal T or Tai signifies the race of men of the children of. If we deconstruct the term Ashanti, we have the children of Ashan or the race of Ashan. Book 1 of Chronicles 4, verse 32. And their villages were Etam and Ayan. And the terminal T or Tai signifies the race of men, the children of. If we deconstruct the term Ashanti, we have the children of Ashan, the race of Ashan. Book 1 of Chronicles, chapter 4, verse 32. And their villages were Etam and Ayan and Rimmon and Tochen and Ashan, five cities. The book of Joshua, chapter 21, verses 13 through 16. Thus they gave the children of Aaron the priest Ashan. Are the Ashanti then the children of the town of Ashan and the descendants of the tribe of Simeon? So he's asking, are the Ashanti the descendants of Simeon? So we're not making this stuff up. People were talking about this stuff. We're not just making this stuff up out of thin air. Is Southern Nigeria, the natives in Southern Nigeria, the natives call black Jews the strange people on the Imo, Yo, Kaim. They are called the Benai Ephraim, the sons of Ephraim. So we have Simeon mentioned. We have Ephraim mentioned. We have Judah mentioned. We're going to get to Levi. Remember this whole Southern Kingdom. Go watch the Go Ask Your Pastor videos. I mentioned that those were the tribes deported from Portugal. The black Jews claim to be deported from Portugal. In Southern Nigeria, the natives call black Jews. Now look at Nigeria and Ghana. I've mentioned Nigeria and Ghana so far. Go look on the map. That's right there in that coast, right around the slave coast, Kingdom of Benin, where our ancestors were deported from West Africa. In Southern Nigeria, the natives call black Jews the strange people on the Imo Yo Kaim. They are called the Benai Ephraim, the sons of Ephraim. They claim that their ancestors came from Morocco, and this is supported by Godby, who noted that their language is a mixture of Maghrebian Arab and ancient Hebrew and local patois. For example, Abu, meaning father, became Yaba. For mother is close to the Hebrew word. These Imo Yo Kaim Jews live in the Ondo district and have a copy of the Torah. The study of customs and rites and the analysis of the semantics of the African tribes have led many of their observers to propose some hypotheses and even draw some conclusions. Dr. Alan H. Godby reached the following conclusion. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. Hundreds of thousands of slaves. Listen again. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa that period? To the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized during wars and sold as slaves. Africans, West Africans that practiced Judaism were more likely than other Negroes to be captured and sold as slaves. Why were Africans practicing Hebrew more likely to be targeted and sold as slaves? Because they were the Israelites. We've already seen them mention Benjamin. We've already seen them mention Simeon. And they were from the tribe. We see the areas called Judah that they were taken from. It is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves to America. How many of them would have been able to conserve some Jewish customs is another question. This conclusion put forth by Godby, which argues for the existence of a more or less recurrent Judaism in West Africa in the same places as those from which the Negroes were taken, is shared by others such as Maurice Delafosse. But most significantly, it has been adopted by a class of educated Black Americans as a key argument to demonstrate that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery to the American continent. Nothing either confirms or repudiates this theory. In fact, we need to be very cautious in this instance. It is difficult to accept without some debate the thesis that these Black slaves, in the frequently unsupportable material conditions in which they were forced to live, were able to conserve, maintain, and transmit a religion such as the Jewish religion. It is commonplace that this religion in particular is subject to strict and well-defined rules of behavior and ritual. Now, understand, he said also that a lot of this was conserved through songs. Go back and listen to a lot of the old Negro spirituals. So I'm going to wrap this up in a minute. I'm going to finish reading this page. In the context, in this context, the case, let me make sure. All right, yeah, in the context of this, in this context, the case of the Islamicized pules can be obvious, can obviously be cited. They were brought in on slave trading boats and knew how to read and write Arabic. But even this instruction, which could have acted as a means of resistance, could not have been transmitted through the group of Black slaves on the plantations. It is easier to accept that the Jews of North Africa and of the Iberian Peninsula had contact with the African Negro bloc, that they were forced to seek refuge in Black Africa and to mix with the indigenous population, and that their descendants kept bits and pieces of the religious customs. It is understandable that the argument for the existence of Black Jewish communities on the African continent acted as the support and the basis for the mythography, because the purpose of myth is not to offer an objective image of the world, but to explain the way in which man is to understand a relation to the man is to understand his relationship, his relation to the world. We cannot, however, see this myth of Black slaves with traditional Jewish faith simply as a straightforward literary philosophical creation. This mythology is weighed down by a whole series of factors, above all, that of the psychology of the Black American. Whatever the possibility of the survival of Black African Judaism through the vicissitudes of slavery, what we have seen is the real context existed in history, and that if Judaism did not continue as it did in Ethiopia with the Falashas, it still left recurrent traces. We could argue then that this organic relationship between Judaism and African cultures of the West Coast had in some way made these populations aware and predisposed them to understand better. Judaism was not totally strange for them. They had been marked by it and had been able to conserve it. It is not then altogether clear that it totally disappeared under the cultural devastation of slavery. Two explanations for the origins of Black American Judaism are both possible and non-contradictory. A sociological explanation emphasizes the influences and the proselytism of the white Jewish communities living alongside the Blacks in the ghettos, which led to conversions, which in turn led to congregation of Black Jews. A historical explanation, which has less clearly defined boundaries, argues for the possible filiation to a Black African Judaism, which was transmitted through the transfer of the population with the slave trade. This explanation also carries with it more ancient filiation to the ancient Hebrews. Both cases employ an explanatory structure which involves a mix of truth and mystery sufficient to feed with symbols of mythology that replaces the direct descendancy of Black Judaism and gives us the interest of seeing the overlap of two convergent roots, that of myth and that of religion. It is at this meeting place that it is easier to see the relations of complicity, continuity and logic which underlie religious discourse and myths. This in turn leads to greater understanding of contemporary Black American consciousness. Now, if you guys want to read through all the rest of this yourself, you're more than welcome to. Shout out to Yaha Ben Marion. Appreciate the super chat. You guys are welcome to go through the rest of this on your own. I will put the link in the description. Yeah, there's a lot there to unpack. There's a lot there to read. But even though he doubts the claims of Israelites, he still presents the information and he still gives us the references to the history to go look for it ourselves. I find this to be very interesting because he points out that there is tons of evidence to support this. He just can't comprehend or understand or believe that it would be preserved through slavery because of what he states, that they were immediately stripped of their language and split apart from their families, stripped of culture, religion, all of that stuff. So understand that we're not making this stuff up. This stuff has been around for a long time. They've known for a fact that there's a distinction between Israelites that practice different belief systems. They've known that for a long time. For the urban apologists and others in the Christian community to act like this is new is just dishonest and disingenuous. So anyway, I'm going to pick this up at a later date because we're having technical difficulties. Thank you to everybody that tuned in. Thank you for everybody that supported via Super Chat. I'm going to be presenting some more evidence and probably reading a little bit longer stuff. God's daughter for the Super Chat. I am going to bring out some more evidence and read more in context so you guys can see it. And I will be posting the links so that way you guys can go back and read it for yourself. But with that said, until next time, I'm out.